Professor Kalam used to say, the purpose of education is to make good human beings with skill and expertise. Enlightened human beings can be created by teachers. Changes in the education policy is a major way to provide the nation better students, professional and better human being. Good morning, one and all present here. I, C.A. Shreya Gupta, Assistant Professor, Faculty of Commerce, Parul University, welcome you all to this webinar. There's no denying the fact that the Indian education system, though one of the credible ones among developing nations, left a lot to be desired, especially on the entrepreneurial front. To keep pace and plug gaps, the government of India has replaced 34-year-old national policy on education with the National Education Policy of 2020, shortly known as NEP. The NEP, as approved by the Union Cabinet, on one hand, promises to make sweeping reforms in education and research, whereas, on the other hand, it aims to create new possibilities for lifelong learning, besides making it industry-oriented with emphasis on entrepreneurship. To talk to us more about how the National Education Policy 2020 would catalyze the growth of entrepreneurship and holistic sustainability, we have a special guest here, and it's a great pleasure for me to introduce our speaker for today, Dr. Amit Chaudhary. An academic by choice to the core, with an interdisciplinary paradigm put to practice, Dr. Amit Chaudhary, a bachelor's in chemical engineering from AEC and master's in business administration from Nagpur University, started his career in business practices and consultations before moving into hardcore academic research and educational administration. Ventured into the realm of research with PhD in educational administration from the MS University of Baroda. With almost 25 years in academics, presently, Dr. Amit is Dean, School of Business Science, USTM, Guwahati University, and also heading its entrepreneurial venture, a project sponsored by NSTEDB DST, the NewGen Innovation and Entrepreneurship Development Center at USTM, which is one among 25 such centers in India. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Dr. Amit Chaudhary. Sir, please take charge of the session.
Thank you, Dr. Shreya. A warm good morning to one and all present here, respected faculties of the esteemed Parul University, Varudra, dear students, and a topic which is rightly given to me says about the role of NEP 2020 in shaping up the entrepreneurial gene amongst our future generation. Whether we can really create the culture of entrepreneurship needs to be seen. However, I'd like to begin the session stating that I have drawn from the NEP 2020 few premises based on which I will give my oration towards how the things could be made possible. And the role of students in making the NEP 2020 really a fruitful one, really a path-defining one, really a catalyst of change that shapes up the future of India. As we know, India is a country with huge demographic dividend, means the societal population is well below in the age group of, say, up to 40. Majority of the population is there. A lot resides on how the major population takes up activities, pursues career of choice, pursues a path that ensures sustainability. Sustainability not only to one's own family, but to the greater society in general. Now here, there are three sections of this particular discourse. One is the NEP 2020, which I will just touch upon, to draw certain aspects that gets mentioned in the policy and how it can be a path changer. The second aspect is entrepreneurship, and the third one is sustainable development. As father of the nation, Mahatma Gandhi has said, India resides in the countryside, the rural sector. And we have been witnessing certain upheavals because the society is very much reluctant towards the path of change. And remember, change is the only constant and change is imminent. There are choices whether to develop, and development is a must. But then at what cost? Whether the development is sustainable is the issue in hand. What development are we talking about? Is the development through creation of jobs? Is the development through creation of industries? Is the development through creation of sustainable ways and means that preserves the scarce resources of Mother Nature for the future generations to come in? And herein, the emphasis of this particular aspect has been well defined in the Sustainable Development Goals given by United Nations 2030. Coming back to the National Education Policy 2020, it rightly mentions, rather redesigns the stages of education from pre-primary, primary, to the secondary level, with an emphasis on the skilling component. Now the question is why? Why the emphasis on skilling component has been given so much? The reality of Indian education for the past, I'd like to put it as 300 odd years, if not the past days since independence. Why 300 odd years? Because the traditional form of Indian education, where it produced global leaders, it produced an economy which is thriving in the world, in between saw certain upheavals. Certain changes were for the good, certain changes were for the bad. When the British came, it formed the basis of the modern Indian education system. But then, the education system was with an objective to create a population which would serve the empire. And now we are an independent India. And in this independence, are we surely independent? Are we having the choices to pursue the career that we like? Are we still independent in our activities? There are a lot remains to be seen because, as reports suggest, we have been producing n number of graduates. When around 15 to 20 years back, the emphasis was on enhancing the gross enrollment ratio. Numerous higher education institutions came in. College education also was flourishing. But then, what it was producing? The STEM, science, technology, engineering and mathematics education was still not given due importance. Though the emphasis was there, somehow the students were reluctant. And majority of our passouts were either from humanities, social science. Second one was engineering, as far as the report says. Third, science and then commerce. Now, the graduates which are in the present market, I would term it as market because once we are producing the graduates, it is a product of the educational system that we have created. And the product goes to the market. And what value does it fetch? If you see, bearing few institutions of national importance and bearing few private universities which are doing exceptional work, be it academics, be it research, majority of our institutions are producing graduates whose workable quotient, whose employable quotient, whose employability does not befit the education that they have pursued. Hence, the importance of Skill India came into the picture. And now, NEP 2020 has rightly emphasized upon skilling. The second premise that I would like to draw upon from the NEP 2020 is establishing of multidisciplinary educational and research universities. Gone are the days when one was pursuing simply business education and carrying forward a career in a big corporate, establishing himself or herself as a manager. The reality today is majority of the business institutes forget about the top rung. I'm calling for the average business institutes. If you look at their placements, either they are underemployed, majority are unemployed. Why? Because they do not have the employable skills. The communication skills, which is of utmost importance, is missing. Hence, the NEP has also rightly emphasized upon the language aspect. Simply sticking to one language or two language won't be the norm in the coming days. Rather, one should empower himself or herself with a number of language. Empower himself or herself with a number of communicability experiences, thereby making himself or herself fit to the requirement of the corporate houses or the industries. But in today's session, the emphasis is on entrepreneurship. And we have some flexible institutions in India, under which I'm pursuing a project, the Entrepreneurship Development Institute of India, which is nearer to Vadodara. It's in Gandhinagar. Then we have the Indian Institute of Entrepreneurship in Guwahati. Apart from this, the entrepreneurial education needs a lot of revamping. We need to create entrepreneurs. If somebody is pursuing history, no wrong in it. If somebody is pursuing English, no wrong in it. But then, our education system such should be such that it provides our students with the opportunity to learn something that makes them earn a meaningful livelihood, earn a fruitful livelihood, create employment rather than seek employment, create a new world for the coming generation without exploiting the existing scarce resource. Therein comes the realm of sustainability. I'd like to cite an example. Here we call the northeast of India a biodiversity hotspot in the world. It has number of flora and fauna. It has number of scenic beauty. It has number of places of importance. Yet one aspect is missing: the thrust to the tourism aspect. So the need of the hour And with the blessings of the NEP 2020, I'm sure the schools and colleges would rightly embrace upon those aspects that are required to create a resource pool of human that would serve the greater industry of tourism. Similarly, another aspect of Northeast India is we are yet majorly an organic area where still our paddy fields are not exploited chemically to the extent where the other parts of India's geography are witnessing the changes. Hence, we are blessed with traditional practices, traditional knowledges, traditional wisdoms that have traversed through ages, but something is missing. The appropriate documentation of the indigenous huge, vast knowledge pool that can well be bought into the realm of the current educational structure. Dear students, why I am saying this is the inquisitiveness must come in your mind. Remember the days when you were kids. Hope you don't remember when you were kids or 1 year old, but definitely you remember seeing a child who is 1 year old or 6 months old. Whenever you ask them, beta, aapki aank kahan hai? They will just give a squint to you. And gradually the kid starts exploring the world with endless number of questions to the parents, to whosoever he or she meets. This inquisitiveness nature, the past education system, rather the existing education system, has somehow failed to sustain among our students. And we as teachers also might have failed to motivate, to create that inner drive within our students to be inquisitive. When the element of skilling comes into the realm of education, with the regular education, be it in science, be it in technology, be it in maths, be it in humanities, the opportunity to learn new trades would definitely create this inquisitiveness, would definitely create the interest among the learners. And here I would like to suggest, rather make a comment, that we Indians, being an agrarian community, agrarian economy, be it an urban school, be it a rural school, the element of agriculture should start. And rather the emphasis of skilling should start with agriculture, horticulture, sericulture, pisciculture, whatever the branches of agriculture are, as short chapters, right from the tender age, to develop that interest among the students. Because the reality here now in rural India is the migration. And until and unless we create this particular interest among our future citizens by imparting them with the knowledge about how a flower blooms, about how the process of farming happens, about how the fishes are reared, about how the poultry is kept. It would be highly impossible for the same student to become a successful mechanical engineer in future, but at the same time contribute to the needy agricultural community which needs appropriate technology at the grassroots level. Why I'm saying this is, once a person pursuing computer science and engineering, suppose in the future, has the element of knowledge on diverse areas of our society, during the schooling or preschooling or primary schooling or secondary schooling level, it won't be possible for him or her to understand the society's need, to understand how to create, what to create, what would be meaningful, and ultimately, what would be the contribution of such individuals individually. But when it combines together, the contribution, just imagine collectively what changes it can bring into our economy. Hope I have addressed the issue with a relevant example, and hope I am able to bring some clarity on what I was trying to tell or express through this particular session. Recently, I had the privilege of working with a financial institution, the Northeastern Development Financial Institution, NEDFI, which was created for development of Northeastern region. And they are coming up with a project for which I was a part of the consultancy team. And it is interesting to note the fact that the realization has begun. And you know, the system that they are trying to work upon is a university specifically on bamboo. I'm just giving an example where whatever courses are being offered, the emphasis will be multidisciplinarity and directed towards the development of bamboo. We need to synergize. We need to relate. We need to bring in all the elements, all the emphasis at the union level. Because many of you might be aware that at the union level, the policymakers are thinking about giving a thrust to a bamboo economy, giving a thrust to the development of a sector which is there since ages, where all our tribes, all our local inhabitants, from morning to evening, from their childhood to the grave, are somehow directly or indirectly related to this particular element called bamboo. And imagine once a university comes where the courses on mechanical engineering will be directed towards development of bamboo technology. The courses of computer science will also focus on bamboos. The courses of mathematics, be it humanities, even English, even literature. Now there was an interesting query, why literature and how will it focus on bamboo? And here is the answer. It is through literature, it is through language that the understanding will happen, the understanding will develop, the documentation will start. About what? About the indigenous traditional knowledge that is hidden or getting lost. Because whatever grandparents practiced, the local medicine, the local food habits, today's kids either do not practice it or have forgotten it. And along with the grandparents, the knowledge is lost. India still is a huge repository to such knowledge stream. Be it the Northeast, be it the central part of India, be it Western India, be it Southern India, you name any bit and piece of India, you name any nook and corner of India, you'll find something which is unique to that particular region. So dear friends, students, the emphasis on entrepreneurship will begin Because as the definition of entrepreneurship is something like creating new, being innovative, and ultimately creating a business. Being innovative, bringing in innovation, doing things in a better way, doing the same things in a new way, be it in a process form, be it in the product form, the newness is the mantra. But where from will the newness come? Until and unless we create within our educational system the ability among our students, the freedom among our students, more than the ability, students are able, mind you. We need to give them freedom to express something new, which unfortunately our educational system has been promoting, something which was bookish in nature, something which was examination oriented, and so on and so forth. There was limitation. A doctor will never study what is accounts, or an accountant or accountancy student will never know what is botany. But with the element that is being brought about by NEP 2020, that is choice based in its true sense, I foresee a cafeteria approach where the student will just go walk into a knowledge cafe, select ABC course, gather the credits, submit the credits, because herein also there is a mention in NEP 2020 that there will be a credit bank. And once you accumulate such credit, you're done with your degree, you're done with your certificate, you're done with your diploma, where the next mention is either you devote your time for X number of months, walk away with the certificate, or Y number of years, walk away with the diploma, or Z number of years, walk away with the degree. Hence, this provides a totally new arena of exploration for the students, wherein now the system will recognize, even if a student is just dropping out after 6 months of his or her enrollment in an undergraduate course, the system will ensure that he or she, provided, have gathered the number of required credits, would walk away with a certificate. And the certificate would ensure his or her vertical mobility, maybe to a different course. So still, I would like to say that the NEP 2020 is work in progress. I somewhere heard, way back during independence, global leaders were saying Indians are good planners, but they fail to execute. I do not remember the quotation, but it's right. Plan is good, the execution is tricky. And the role during the execution, the role during the element lies upon us. And when I say us, the learners too, the teachers too, the parents, the entire community. The community, the ecosystem, the educational ecosystem. The onus is on us. The onus is on the present graduates who might one day become teachers. And the onus is on the teachers to cultivate this particular thought among the students, so that contribution in the form of entrepreneurship, in the form of innovative ideas towards implementation of the same in a seamless way is being made possible. I would have loved to have an interactive session, but with request of the organizers, if somebody would forward me a question or two, It would be more helpful to make the session an interesting one. May I request Dr. Shreya, if it's possible, for a question?
Yes, sir. It's very much possible.
Yeah.
But should we keep it like at the end, or you want to answer
in
the
question? In between, if I can take one or two questions, then it becomes more relevant, because ultimately it is the learner who wants to know.
Yes. So I have received this one question wherein a friend of mine is watching this webinar on FB, Facebook Live, and she's asking that, Shreya, we are already done with the studies and all. What does the policy have for us, people like us, have already like graduated, we're already on the in the market now. So does the policy have anything to offer to those who are already done with their studies? Can they go the back?
The policy also rightly mentions about the element of lifelong learning.
Correct.
And when the element of lifelong learning comes in here, as I have cited the example, a graduate may just wind up his or her study within 6 months of his or her enrollment in the undergraduate program due to some compulsions.
Right.
He walks away from the university ecosystem or college ecosystem with a certificate. He pursues a career, and one fine day he realizes, I need to pursue the degree program. He comes back with the definite credit, enrolls himself or herself at the next higher level. Again, after 1 or 2 years, he goes out with a diploma, again works, or again sets his own business, again come back to the ecosystem, and the mobility is therein. There are no age limitation, or there are no mention of age limitation as such.
That's great.
Yeah. So dear friends, the element of entrepreneurship, why entrepreneurship is not happening the way it should happen? Why is it that it's not picking up the way the other economies have picked up? One sure answer to it is we have started late. We have started late, but better late than never. What we have started late? Say our immediate neighbor, who is a giant as far as economy is concerned now, started way back in 1980s. With some far-sighted policies. I won't deal with the realm of their system and our system, but then the emphasis was on the future, far-sightedness was on a long-term planning. In India, however, though we have started our process of liberalization, our process of opening up the economy a bit at a later level, barring few communities or barring few regions, in India, we do not have that particular gene to become an entrepreneur. Still, majority of the entrepreneurs are not by choice. It's by force that they are doing something in order to earn a living. Though the recent trends are very positive in nature, for the past 5 to 10 years, India has recorded the largest ecosystem of startups in the world. Many startups are being started. Many unicorn companies have been formed. But what sector are we dealing with? Which sector are we dealing with? Is that particular sector really sustaining our economical growth? Is that particular sector contributing to the real sustainable development which we are talking about, or that the United Nations have emphasized upon? It needs to be seen how many startups are working at the rural sector to promote agriculture. Yes, there are success stories of IITians, there are success stories of IIM graduates taking up paddy cultivation, taking up new methods of hydroponics, aquaponics, floricultures, and mixed farming, hydroponics with fish farming and whatnot. Whether those models are scalable, if yes, to what extent has it been scaled? Are the remaining population taking it up? The contribution has to be a wholesome. We have started something, there should be few takers from other sectors also to contribute to the overall buildup of an ecosystem. Say, for example, a village X in a remote corner of Northeast. I'm just giving a hypothetical example. The village X from a remote corner of Northeast is excellent producer of exotic flowers, organic vegetables, organic fruits. Then are those produce reaching the place which is called the market? Here we need to examine, and who will examine this? The nearest college or the school or the university system must gear up, must pick up areas of research that would promote the development of such region. And the reality here is that remote X village of Northeast India is almost 3,000 kilometers from Mumbai, almost 2,500 kilometers or 2,200 kilometers from Delhi, but it is hardly 50 kilometers from, say, the nearest town in China or the nearest town in Myanmar. Since 90s, we have been talking about Lucas policy, reframed as activist policy, and the emphasis on the Asian Highway number 1, which connects India to Thailand, will open up new vistas to promote the local produce, and the farmers, the producers, will be eagerly producing and happily selling. But then, are the farmers still farming the same thing? Are we creating a group of educated farmers who are knowledgeable, who are skillful enough to exploit whatever is being abundantly given by Mother Nature without really exploiting it, but engaging in the process of sustainable development? These are the elements that are to be taken up by academicians, by researchers, by students, and explored upon to find an answer how to create. And the moment you come out with the answer how to create, 50% of the task of setting up the entrepreneurial venture is over. Remaining 50% is being linked up with all the policies and programs of the respective state governments or the union government. And policies are plenty that promotes entrepreneurship, but takers are few. Gone are the days where takers were only the privileged class. We were blessed with education. We had an education system, and we definitely had some educated, unemployed people who ventured back to farming. But the benefit of that particular education system was we had a aware lot of farmers. We had an alert group of farmers who were well versed with such schemes. So it's a both way process. The emphasis from the government has been rightly multifarious in nature. Hope all of you have heard about the aspirational district programs. With four of the districts in Northeast India, I was also associated. The aspirational district program is one such developmental measure that the government has taken. But then, though the government has taken something, the takers has to be the community. And an uneducated or unskilled community will never be able to take up that particular benefits. Hence, the element which I won't name has plagued the Indian society will gradually diminish. and people will be more productive, and people will be rightfully venturing into areas which were unexplored, which were unthought of. In Indian ethos, in Indian minds, we have this feeling, beta engineer ya doctor nahi banega, then the entire life is gone. But then there are a lot of professions apart from engineering and doctors or medical science. Our teachers has to be aware about what are the career prospects, what are the career progression plans, because you cannot expect the child to know until and unless you feed them with those potential opportunities. So to sum up the session, it's indeed a boon that we have, after 30 plus long years, shaped up the NEP 2020. The onus lies upon us as citizens of the country, as teachers, as students, as practitioners, as businessmen, as professionals, to embrace the change and to contribute towards the growth. With this, I'd like to conclude my session and would welcome a few questions from the audience as well as the students. Thank you very much. Dr. Shreya?
Yes, sir. Okay, so the session is open to questions. I request my colleagues, if they have any questions, they can just put forward. Meanwhile, I'll also check if I have received any questions from our students. Yeah.
Yes, our fellow faculties also may pose questions and make it a more interactive one.
So, sir, I have received a question from a student. He says that the policy claims that universities from the top 100 countries of the world, they can set up their campus in India. What do you think about it? What, if you can put some light on it?
Okay, if the foreign universities comes and set up centers here, what will be the pros and what will be the cons? Pros, the benefits are plenty, because they will come up with expertise, they will come up with a new knowledge pool, they will come up with an experience lot, they will come up with new ideas. The cons are heavily against us teachers, because we need to survive. Why I say so? Because we are now leisurely moving in the direction of carrying forward our duties. I won't say the whole lot of thesis do it. Myself, I am a lazy man, so I explore a bit less. So challenges will be on the part of people like me to get more publications, right, to get credible publications, to provide something which is a benefit to the student. Otherwise, the student will just carry a certificate from my institute and move into their certificate for another diploma.
Right.
So that will create a healthy competition, and ultimate will be the promotion of education, and the winner will be the learners.
Right. So it's a win-win situation for the learners, but of course, those who are engaged in the educational field, they will have to really work very hard.
They will have to reinvent themselves. They will have to reinvent themselves. They will have to explore specialized areas where they can explore and contribute.
Yeah, so I think there's no looking back. I think for everyone, there's a lot that this policy is offering to the learners as well as to the academicians. Sir, what do you think, what the parents, like, I think, as you said, कि हर पेरेंट का ऐसा होता है कि मेरा बच्चा डॉक्टर बने या इंजीनियर बने, हाउ डू यू थिंक द पेरेंट्स ऑल्सो माई चेंज देयर आइडियोलॉजीज, लाइक हाउ डू यू थिंक दे शुड ऑल्सो लर्न फ्रॉम दिस पॉलिसी जस्ट सो दैट
Luckily, the task of changing the ideology of parents are being minimized now, because the parents of today are definitely the parents who have been born post-independence and born with the modern system of education and born with a wider outlook. So definitely the task will change over a period of time. And it won't be the same, what you say, issue. Today you have parents entertaining and understanding the realm of work from home.
Yes.
Had it been 10 years back that my child has come from Delhi and says he is working from home, then I would have booked another ticket and send him back to Delhi.
True.
The situations are making parents also understand the reality. And whatever cannot be communicated through language or through articles or through the convincing mode definitely is being learned through experience. That's what I feel.
True. So after listening to all that you shared today, it shows that you are very much attached to agriculture and you love nature and you want something to be done about it. So I think... do you think that this policy opens the door for a lot of field work for the students when they are studying? Of course,
definitely. See, with this particular policy coming in, hope you are aware that for research funding, there will be a separate agency. Now, how are we securing DST or ICSSR fund? We just write a minor report, a minor project, and we submit it and we get some XY amount of fund.
Yes.
But whether that research is meaningful, the question is to be answered. Whether that research is applicable to the societal good, it's to be seen. Now, I foresee a situation where the research areas itself will be decided maybe by a core group. And the research area will be inviting applications from applicants who are willing to work in those areas.
That's quite interesting, yeah.
And here there will be the change that no longer people will just submit something mechanically and get some fund and write. 90% of the time, reports are also mechanically written.
Right.
And whatever the survey studies says or whatever the survey studies are being undertaken, I fear whether it is holistically done, I fear whether it is truly done. So it needs to be seen whether the new system will really energize a group which will decide upon the direction through which the research process has to traverse, so that the contribution or the outcome of such research becomes socially meaningful.
Right.
Yeah.
Rightly said. So the research will not happen by force, but yes, people will take up those topics which interest them.
Yeah.
So I think, what do you think the employers, like suppose if we are research scholars and we do research sometimes by force, sometimes because we really like to research on that topic. Mm-hmm. I think what I have experienced most of the times is even I am very, like nature interests me. And sometimes I wish to write a research article or write a research paper on, let's say, some social issue or some mishap that has happened. But then the employers, sometimes they are not very happy about it. Like they'll be, you are a chartered accountant. You are not supposed to write papers on such things. You must be writing only and only about taxation and accounting. So yes. I think, do you think this policy will change this aspect?
See, when the types of university will be categorized as academics or research or multidisciplinary education and research university, MERU, then this element will no longer exist where you will be forced to write papers only on accountancy. Yes, you write accountancy. You write paper on accountancy. Hope you have heard about green accountancy. So
yes.
You will start writing about what you have given to the Mother Nature and what Mother
Right.
Nature has given you.
Yes, true.
So you explore in that area. Suppose I cite another example, say a village X. Now when say our objective of sustainable development is to make the whole village sustainable in itself, number one, what we need to do is we need to study the ecosystem that the village provides. Maybe the ecosystem for agriculture, maybe the ecosystem for business. And these aspects cannot be studied standalone.
Right.
What it needs is, it needs multidisciplinarity. You need botanists, you need agriculturists, you need veterinarists, you need people from commerce, business, you need people from technology to come together, brainstorm, evolve, provide solution so that the village people are happy staying at village and earning much more than the urban residents.
Right, true.
And it is very much possible.
So, what we all can interpret from what you are saying is a child should know very well about the ecosystem of the place where he resides, or where he lives, or where he belongs to. And I think everything that happens later in the life of that child largely depends on that, the knowledge of the ecosystem. And then I think that's the time when he'll be able to actually contribute.
Contribute, yes.
Yes.
Let's say we are brought up, we develop our thought process by the, what you say, ambience that we get during our childhood.
Right.
During our school days. And majority of our period is during our school days. Now say, if I ask my fellow faculties, how many of you know gardening? How many of you know to raise vegetables? Even if it is like that you reside in flat, and if I say there is a technology which exists called hydroponics and you can grow your fresh vegetable within a small area of 10 square feet, and will you be interested to go for that technique? And majority will say yes. Now had these elements, these are small techniques, these are small hobbies. I remember having a period during our school days. I was from Kendriya Vidyalaya, and we had a subject called Socially Useful Productive Work, SUPW. Hope you have heard about that subject, SUPW, Socially Useful Productive Work. Now, these are the elements that were taught in SUPW. People were taught about how to fix a electrical gadget, or how to fix a, means everything that is required in terms of skill to be a complete human within your home context. So whatever you consume within your home, if you know about it, whatever you consume within your society, if you know about it, in a future course of your career, when you become a computer scientist or when you become a mechanical scientist, you definitely bring along with you that particular thought process, and your contribution is higher.
Yes. So I think even in this corona pandemic, during the lockdown, even the Prime Minister suggested that we all should become self-reliant, because if I want to get my hair cut, you know, the salon is not open, then what should I be doing? If the tap is not working, some plumbing work is to be done. So I think, as you rightly said, we should all have some basic knowledge.
Basic knowledge of anything and everything. Yeah.
Yes, that exists in our place. Yes.
It's literally not possible for a person to know everything. But then whatever he is interested in or she is interested in.
Right, right.
And you give them that menu. The way you get a menu in the restaurant, in your classroom also you need to provide them a menu.
Right.
And when you are providing the menu, the teacher must be sure that you are also well versed with the menu.
Yes. Yeah, of course. So I think nowadays when we see that the students don't actually want to come to the campus, you know, they just come by force. And when we say them, okay, your attendance is getting marked and you must be present at least for these many lectures to be able to, you know, sit for the exam. I think if we provide them these menus,
those attendance or securing attendance will now gradually take the shape of securing credits. And mind you, today, the amount of effectiveness I as a teacher in the classroom provide is much, much, much more lower then the amount of effectiveness I provide them as a facilitator.
Right.
So as a facilitator, what I do is, those who are in the class, they enjoy my lecture. Those who are not in the class, they are in the blended mode. They are given the resources for pursuing their own, at their own pace. So learning happens in any case. And the strange fact is, the student who is having 40% ascendance, his examination result is around 75% plus.
True.
So how do you correlate being present in the class itself would mean that you are knowledgeable?
Of course.
The classroom you need to see why do you visit a particular restaurant? You visit a particular restaurant because the dishes there are good. So similar, when I say cafeteria approach, maybe there will be 4 English classes going simultaneously and student category A will go to A class, B category will go to B class. There may be many options.
Yes.
Yeah. But the change is not instantly happening. It will take years.
Right, it will take years. But I think slowly and gradually it is happening. And if we provide these menus, that you can learn a lot while you are studying, I think.
Definitely.
Yeah.
As a teacher, I need not. I am a teacher of, say, partially engineering and partially management science and partially also educational administration. So as a teacher, I am not supposed to teach my student how to grow vegetable. But if I come up with a menu that provides valuable resources, maybe a YouTube link, maybe a particular, there is a short video of 10 minutes. So I provide them. I find it interesting. I provide them to my students. So here now a stage will come where any teacher will develop their own course, their own curriculum. They will offer it like in the West.
Right. Because everyone has hobbies, right?
Yes.
Every person has hobbies and they can just enhance it more and create a curriculum out of it and which they can offer to the students, and those who are interested can opt and learn something about it. I think there's not enough that we can talk about all this. It was such a wonderful session and it was full of knowledge. And thanks a lot, sir, for sparing your valuable time. And for sharing your experience and sharing your insights with us. Thank you so much. I thank you very much on behalf of our viewers and also on behalf of Faculty of Commerce. It was a pleasure to have you, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Good day.
Thank you so much, sir. Good day to you too. Thank you.